And they found that for that very term and bond, there are two components to the rate of return, which I will call R. First is the coupon payment itself, which is fixed over time. For example, perhaps you will receive an interest payment, that is a coupon of $1,000 first per year. Otherwise, you can also make money by selling the bond itself on the open market at plan T. So there is the capital gain. You bought the bond, let's say at $1,000 at plan T minus one last year. And then this year, you sold the bond for $2,000. This is R is a rate of return. So this is comparing your gain from the bond, if you do gain, relative to the price of the bond. And that's the coupon bond. Another type of asset, a type of bond that governments still use from time to time. It's the council bond. This bond never matures, and instead of maturing, it will pay a given interest rate every year for as long as you are holding the bond. So in this case, suppose that I is the interest rate on the bond. And C is the payment of interest to you, the bond holder, just like a coupon. And then TV is the present value of the bond, just the value today of the bond. You can think of TD, in this case, as being like the money that you had in a savings account. Each year, you earn interest on that principal at the rate of I. So there is your annual payment of interest to you earn upon the principal of TV. So for example, suppose that the interest rate is 10%. The amount in your bank account is $1,000. Then the interest payment to you is 10% of $1,000 or $100 per year. Because the bond never matures, it always pays the $100 for as long as you're holding the bond at the given interest rate in the dividend price. The council raises an intriguing question about how dividends financial operations. Then the government sells to you and I a control bond. It is ensuring, guaranteeing that it will pay us basically forever for as long as we hold the bond. And the question is, why would any government be so crazy as to promise never-ending payments when instead they could have had a bond that matures, goes away in just a few years? But the coupon bond. Why would the government favor a console over a coupon bond? That's the question. So what do you think? As an example, England, during the Napoleonic Wars of the early 1800s, is still at that time had issued total bonds and is still paying on those bonds today. Why would the government do that? Well, one possibility may be that the government is trying to shift to you and I, or our children and our grandchildren, the financing of the bond. England in 1803, issued the bond, but did not have to pay pretty much on the bond because the government was in office for only a few years. After that, future government will have to pay future generations, but today's government is not concerned with that. Today's government is trying to minimize its expense of financial operations by the war. And then finally, here's a question of relevance to Kazakhstan, which from time to time has a bubble in housing prices. In other words, sometimes, such as in 2007, housing prices increased with unexpected rapidity. They're quickly increasing. And the question is, why would we have that kind of bubble in housing prices? Well, one answer may be that it becomes relatively cheaper and cheaper to finance the purchase of a home because mortgage rates are not rising very, very fast. And that housing prices are rising at a different rate, a lower rate of increase. So I think that I have this turned around, that the mortgage rate is rising more rapidly than housing prices. So financing the purchase of a home is increasing more quickly than the price of the home itself. But if you buy the home becomes an asset for you. So you would be glad to see the price of your asset to be rising. But in this case, the cost of financing the home is rising more rapidly than the value of the asset to you over time. So this may make people less likely to buy homes, since the cost of the home is increasing more rapidly than the value. One way that the government can get around that problem, if it wants to encourage home ownership, is to subsidize the mortgage rate. The United States business, for example, it provides a tax deduction for mortgage payments. And that takes care of the basic issues in Chapter 4, the introduction to interest rates. The main point to bear in mind is that there is an inverse relationship between the interest rate and the price of the asset. This is a bond. So in simple terms, the asset price rises like a bond. The interest rate earned on that asset falls. For example, if we have a $500 coupon payment to you, the bondholder, and the initial bond price was $1,000, the interest rate in this case is 50%, pretty generous. Now, on the open market, the bond price rises to $5,000. But the coupon payment remains at $500 annually, because this is a fixed rate coupon bond. In that case, the interest rate on the bond now is the payment of interest of $500 relative to the current bond price on the market of $5,000. The interest rate is 10%. The bond price has risen from $1,000 to $5,000, and the interest rate accordingly has fallen from 50% to 10%. That is the main point of the chapter. Is it comfortable with this inverse relationship between bond prices and interest rates? Okay, good. I thought that you might enjoy completing an introductory discussion of interest rates with an issue that is in the world news today, especially in Burma. And here is the news. As you already know, a few months ago, the military in Burma seized power from the legitimately elected president. So the army now is running Burma, not democratic leaders. People are uncertain about what will happen next. So the Burmese, just to be on the safe side, are withdrawing the money from the banks just to keep it at home in case they need to have savings that they can spend when they lose their jobs in the uncertainty. The problem for the banks is that at any time, they have only part of the money that depositors have provided them with. The rest of the money that they have lent out to other people for loans, that they put money on the interest rate, the interest payment on those loans. So if everybody shows up at the bank, all depositors demanding the money right away, the bank has got to close its doors because it does not have enough money to satisfy the depositors. So a provincial bank in Burma has tried to resolve this problem by limiting the amount of money that depositors can take out of the bank today. About $150. The fiat is the Burmese currency. And here is a picture from the Financial Times newspaper of people outside of the bank waiting to be able to enter the bank and withdraw money. You can see that they anticipate waiting for hours, so they have put umbrellas, games, food. Looks like a queue line for bread in Soviet Russia. Okay, so here's several questions that you may enjoy thinking about. We have political uncertainty in Burma or Myanmar at this time. How would you expect that uncertainty to affect the demand for cash? And how would that change in money demand affect interest rates and output in Burma in the short run? So at this point, we have a constant money supply. That is, there is a fixed number of fiats that are circulating in Burma. And for simplicity, people assume a closed economy. In other words, people ignore imports and exports for Burma. So I think that the problem is worth 4 points of extra credit. I will give you a couple of minutes to think about it, and then we will reconvene as a class to discuss possible solutions. 3 or 4 minutes now. Okay, thank you. is the demand to hold cash likely to rise or to fall in this case? Look, it's been already witnessing in Burma, people demand more cash to hold, not to spend, but to hold. In case things get worse, so money demand is rising, but we assumed that money supply does not change. The supply of fiat is fixed. So we have excess money demand. How does this affect interest rates and output or real income? The same thing. This is a very good opportunity to use the ISLM model. So you remember that a real and non-real sectors in equilibrium are determining the interest rate. And GDP. Also equal to real income. But real, I mean that we have adjusted for price changes. And you remember that demand for goods and services is higher at lower interest rates because it's easier for firms to pay a low interest rate and take up a loan that depends on extension of its capacity. And the same thing for consumers. If the interest rate goes down on educational loans, you will take advantage of that and buy tuition or enroll in a university that charges you tuition. So there is the real sector, GDP, the usable purchases by households, firms, and government, and the people in war of the international trade. And remember that to the real sector, we can add the monetary sector, or non-real just means that we're not talking about physical quantities, but the property and automobiles. Instead, we're talking about money. Everywhere on the 11th term, money supply equals money demand. So this is a schedule of equilibrium points. This SEIS is a schedule of equilibrium in the real sector that is equating savings to investment. perfect love in Burma. She had a voice in many demands. This schedule no longer depicts equilibrium. All points on LML are out of equilibrium. Because of excess money demand. So we would like to find a way to reduce money demand so that we are back in equilibrium, but money supplies are given. Is then equal to money demand. We look for the equilibrium because we want to predict what will happen in Burma in the weeks to come. Economists argue that markets tend toward a state of rest that they can predict when they are in equilibrium. So, in which direction should we shift the LM curve? To the right or to the left? Due to excess money demand. You remember that the demand to hold money depends on income. And also, on the interest rate. The two effects are offset. Higher income will raise money demand, and but higher interest rates will reduce money demand because people then are not holding the money, instead they spend it on assets that will pay at a higher interest rate. Income raises money demand and interest rates. When they increase, lower money demand. Okay. So we are now in disequilibrium along the schedule. To return to equilibrium, we have to find an arrangement that will get rid of the excess money demand. One possibility is that we hold the interest rate constant and lower national income. So if income is falling, people are not accumulating cash and overspend it in the next few days. Instead, they are saving their money. This means that the LM schedule is shifting to the left. Or for the LM prime. So this new LM curve is back in equilibrium. The main demand once again is equal to the given supply of fiat. So what is happening in Burma? due to the military coup. Before the coup, people at point A, the bill and the military sectors are in general equilibrium. And now we have a shift to the left of the PLM schedule. So a new equilibrium appears at B as compared to A in this case. But then, if we change the jitter to dip in output and in the interest rate, it looks like Burma will face higher interest rates. And lower income. A way of understanding why interest rates will rise is to suppose that the old constant output or income, and then just about what would have to happen to the interest rate to reduce money demand. Of course, the interest rate would have to rise. So, for example, if we hold constant output at the level of Y1, then the interest rate must rise. At this income, we would be at point C if income did not change. So the interest rate is rising from A to C in order to reduce money demand. So there is the sad story about Burma. The Financial Times reports that the country is not yet in a financial crisis, but I suspect that you, as an economist, would predict that crisis is just around the corner for Burma. So now, let's look at the impact of the bank's policy of limiting withdrawals of money from checking accounts. One problem is that the limit on withdrawals is a signal to depositors that the money is at risk. The bank is worried about running out of money because of withdrawals. So the limit itself on withdrawals may lead to a larger and faster bank run than would have been the case had the banks not tried to limit the withdrawals. That particular policy may not be a success. So let's think about what the government in Burma may be able to do to avoid recession and to avoid bank runs. Well, what does Kazakhstan do to avoid bank runs, such as had almost happened 7 years ago when there was on the social media false rumors about major banks collapsing in Kazakhstan? Well, let's see. And Kazakhstan, they have deposit insurance. And what is that? Just a common sense definition. What is deposit insurance? Well, the central bank guarantees that depositors can withdraw the money up to a particular limit. This is a guarantee by the government. That depositors, especially small depositors, can withdraw the money anytime that they wish. So if the commercial bank does not have that money, the national bank will step in and provide the difference. Why might deposit insurance be a good idea? But let's see, if you know that you can get your money back at any time, you are less likely to demand your money immediately without worry because you have insurance on the deposit of the central bank. Depositors know that they can get their money back at any time. So they do not run on the bank. Demanding all the money back immediately. Deposit insurance is a way of avoiding bank runs. But instead, what Burma has done is to give the processors a signal that the money is in danger, and therefore they're demanding the money back right now. It's like a self-fulfilling prophecy. So there is one possible solution to the financial crisis in Burma. Just do what other central banks do and guarantee the deposits up to some amount. And then the second question was, what can the government in Burma do to avoid recession? Again, the ISLM Keynesian analysis may suggest a solution. So there is the real sector either schedule. Here is the allowance schedule. Now, because of the coup, people are hoarding their cash at home because they are not spending the money or put the fall. All then has shifted to the left. So, what can the government do to return LM to its original schedule? Now, on LM, money demand is greater than money supply. At the moment, LM is out of this equilibrium. What can the central bank do? The central bank of Myanmar. To return the equilibrium. Because if we can go back to the original element schedule, there will be no change in the interest rate and no change in output. One that increase the money supply. Since the whole problem was that we had excess money demand, we're not satisfied the higher money demand, the increasing money supply. Among other effects, this increase in checking accounts and currency gives people more money to spend and also more confidence in spending that money. According to the Financial Times, the Central Bank of Burma does have money on hand and they can increase the money supply, but for unspecified reasons, the bank is reluctant to do so. So it appears as if the financial crisis in Burma was manufactured by the government itself and by the traditional banks. People are running on the banks because the banks have not guaranteed their deposits. And people are hoarding money rather than spending it because the central bank has not provided them with enough money. It's a mess that should not be happening. It should be obvious in Burma, I think, that they need to trust the insurance and the accommodative monetary policy. Okay, so I will pause there. In a case study of Burma, and encourage you to go on and to read chapter 5, which is more of an analysis of interest rates than chapter 4 had been. I have already reported for you a lecture about the first half of chapter 5 on the bond market. So if you are interested, just to take a look at the video at any time. It's on the middle page right there.